What the pyramid at Cañada de la Virgen is located at what is considered the northernmost expansion of the Mesoamerican civilization. When we explore the essence of Cañada de la Virgen, its significance in human history should be considered as a part of the history of the development of all human culture. What was formerly the exclusive work of anthropologists and archaeologists is now being greatly facilitated and enhanced by geneticists at the Genographic Project of the National Geographic Society. The migration patterns of our early ancestors are now being mapped with genetic evidence. Anthropologists have identified, and genetics is now confirming, seven regions as origins of advanced human civilizations. Known as culture arts, they are Mesopotamia, the Nile Valley of Egypt, West Africa, the Ganges and Indus Valleys of India, the Yellow River Valley in China, and across the vast Pacific Ocean, Peru and Mesoamerica. Mesoamerica includes the northern part of Costa Rica, Nicaragua, Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala, Belize, and most of the southern half of Mexico. Cañada de la Virgen is located at what is considered to be the northernmost limits of the Mesoamerican realm. The pyramid complex is believed to be an Otomi Chichimeca archaeological site and the northernmost pre-Columbian Mesoamerican site ever to be found. There are 10 characteristics that define and are found in all Mesoamerican cultures. They are: number 1, human and animal sacrifices. Number 2, pyramid building. 3, a complex calendar system. 4, a complex pantheon of gods and goddesses. Number 5, a religion based on ancestral veneration, with deities reincarnated as the ruling class. Number 6, dramatic alteration of one's physical appearance among the elite. 7, handwritten history, astronomy, and religion recorded on bark paper folded like a concertina, called a codex. Number 8, long-distance trade. And number 9, the Mesoamerican ball game. And 10, a diet based on the three sisters, corn, beans, and squash, grown in a symbiotic relationship. The Otomi Indians have lived in the valley of San Miguel de Allende for thousands of years. It is presumed that construction at Cañada de la Virgen most likely began after the collapse of Teotihuacan around 530 AD. The pyramid complex is located about 15 miles or 25 kilometers from San Miguel de Allende in the province of Guanajuato. Among the characteristics that make it exceptional is that it is oriented toward the west and the setting sun and moon, the realm known as the Land of the Dead. Thus, astronomical events through the year take on a different significance for the culture that evolved around this orientation of the complex, as most ceremonial centers within the same cultural region are oriented toward the east and the rising sun and moon. This is a pre-Hispanic site that was ruled by the moon, the sun, and Venus, as demonstrated by archaeological astronomical studies by the National Institute of Anthropology and History. Cañada de la Virgen translates as the Canyon of the Virgin Mary. It is so named because in the late 1920s, a man found a geode along the Laja riverbed, which revealed a likeness of the Virgin Mary when broken apart. That image was kept at the temple near the edge of the canyon where many of the workers lived. Many miracles have been attributed to the Virgin since then. There is an abundant variety of plant life in the surrounding area. The most important plant is the nopal cactus. It is edible, nutritious, and medicinal. Its fruit is the prickly pear, which is also edible. The juice is very slimy and sticky and is used to make paint and adhesives. It was used to make the mortar, which holds the pyramid together. As visitors move along the hand-built road and bridge across the river, they can see the beautiful multicolored rock formations in the canyon. A shaded gazebo provides a resting place and an opportunity to learn about the approach. From the shaded rest area, we join a ceremonial avenue which ascends the hillside. Coming from the symbolic underworld, the bottom of the canyon, visitors would rise to the heavens up the causeway with gifts and tributes to the elite priests who lived there and were considered the gods incarnated. The axis of symmetry rises up the causeway through the doorway of the patio, separating the pyramid into two equal halves. The entire site is oriented around this axis of symmetry. On April 17th and August 25th, the sun rises in the east directly in line with that axis. These dates are called first planting and first harvest. When the pyramid first comes into view on the ascent up the causeway, there's a staging area where visitors pause to rest and eat and prepare themselves for entrance to the sacred precinct. The site was first registered by the National Institute of Anthropology and History in 1985. Excavation began in 2001, and the pyramid was opened to the public in February of 2011. Albert Tyler Coffey will be our guide to the pyramid complex. Albert studied anthropology at Louisiana State University. He pursued his interests in a Mesoamerican anthropology with further study in Belize, Guatemala, and Nicaragua. He came north to San Miguel de Allende to work with Gabriela Zepeda Garcia Morena, the chief investigator from the National Institute of Anthropology and History. His hands-on experience excavating the pyramid and his educational background have given him a unique understanding of the pyramid and the Mesoamerican culture. We now join Albert Coffey Archeotours as we begin the ascent of the causeway.
And you see the pyramid and the hill behind it rise into view together at the same time, a dramatic visual effect they took advantage of. At that point, they discovered evidence in the soil for organic refuse and cooking. So that was like a staging area where they would stop for an extended amount of time to give honor and prepare themselves for more limited access into the sacred precinct. When we get to that spot, I'll let you know, and if you're ready, we'll start our ascent. Where they discovered evidence for organic refuse. So if you can see the pyramid and the hill coming into view, this is where they stopped for an extended amount of time and then continued probably single file from this point to a gateway that was only about a meter wide. This image was found painted in the center of a bowl that was an offering for one of the burials. It's become the official symbol for the site. So botanists had an idea about 5 years ago to take stones like this that come from fallen structures and build low walls in this shape. And in each moon, a different type of plant is on display. Anyway, but I'll point out the most important parts and some of the artifacts on display. And then we'll get to Complex D, the House of the Wind. All circular structures like this, you can imagine the shape of a coiled snake or spiral being the symbol for the wind, like a whirlwind. An important burial was discovered here, I'll tell you about when we get there. And then the Complex B, the House of the Longest Night, which I mentioned is oriented towards the setting sun on the winter solstice. Rooms on top of these platforms where priests live. The pyramid on the corner is so unique, only two like it have ever been discovered, and I'll share with you why that is when we get there. And at this point, I'm going to talk about the Mesoamerican ball game. Because there's always a ball court associated with a site like this. In this case, they have not detected one yet, but this may be it. Inside this yellow line, the potential zone of investigation. So that'll be the next area they study when the funding comes through, which could be years from now. Room 3 of the southern platform, 11 human burials discovered beneath the floor. Most interesting, the young warrior, that last photograph I showed you in the book, and I'll tell you about that child when we get here. Then we'll go around into the patio at the top of the pyramid for my climactic presentation, and then out again. And what you see up ahead of you, Complex A, the main patio pyramid complex they call the House of the 13 Heavens. I mentioned Mesoamerican peoples had a vision for 13 levels for the heavens, 9 levels for the underworld. There are 12 rooms, 4 on each platform surrounding the patio, number 13 being the temple at the top. And the way that Gabriela Cepeda, the lead archaeologist, describes this, she believes there may have been a priest that lived in each one of these rooms who was the incarnation of the god that oversaw that level of heaven, number 13 reserved for the high priest or ruler. But all these names for these buildings were given to them recently by archaeologists. We don't know what they were back then because only one piece of writing has been discovered so far. Hopefully in the future they'll find more. Long distance trade is necessary for any advanced civilization. This is arid America, true desert, hunters and gatherers. From here south, a distinct long enough rainy season to bring about agriculture, the rise of advanced civilization. But down in Costa Rica, Nicaragua, and Panama, those are what we call loosely organized tribal societies that are never part of a larger culture hearth. But inside of this culture hearth known as Mesoamerica, 68 different languages were spoken. 68 different ethnic groups, all considered Mesoamerican, because they shared those traits I mentioned earlier. The diet, the religion, architecture, things like that. So they were all intimately tied together through trade, partially because of topography. Mexico is so mountainous that if you flattened it out, it would cover Asia. If you took a flat Asia and you squeezed it up like an accordion, that's how much land area is exposed. The fifth most biodiverse country in the world, alpine, lowland, coastal, inland, tropical, arid, subtropical, semi-arid, karst being the limestone shelf of the Yucatan. So no one spot are you ever completely self-sufficient over the course of a year. You have to import and export. Turquoise pieces coming from New Mexico, we call that the Turquoise Trail, an intimate link to the American Southwest. Jadeite up from Guatemala. This shell necklace, mother of pearl pendant, shell pendant and beads coming from both coasts. Black obsidian pieces from the various volcanic mountains around us. This is their trademark style of pottery, their main export item. It's called raised white. Comes from a special type of clay that is mined in just one spot outside of Comin Fort, about 20 miles from here. They discovered that style pottery as far away as Mexico City, Querétaro, and Hidalgo. There's still people on the outskirts of town making pottery almost identical to that. And this is called Enuñe. Enuñe is a figurine depicting a priest with a sacrificial knife and a bag of incense. Figurines almost identical to that with the square nose and all have been discovered in the tombs of the Zapotec and Mixtec of Oaxaca, another link to Oaxaca through art. And these are new signs. They just put them up recently. In the old sign, the same photograph was displayed, but right here they were depicted three sharpened bone needles about this long. They were found right next to the king and his burial. I would ask people, what do you think those were used for? And usually they would answer me, maybe sewing, tattooing, piercing, acupuncture. But they were actually bloodletting instruments. Cactus spines, stingray spines, sharpened bone, obsidian for cutting, used to extract blood from different parts of the body that was then dripped onto bark paper. That bark paper was burned and smoked and an offering to the gods. Sometimes the blood was drained directly into the earth or into receptacles in the shapes of sacred animals. In the artwork, a beheading is seen taking place at the end of a ball game, and that is associated with a bountiful harvest. But to be more precise, these daily bloodletting rituals called reciprocal or auto-sacrifice were practiced by an elite-level priest who believed that human blood was the most sacred substance on earth and necessary as an offering to keep the cycles of the sun and moon in motion. To keep the cycles of the cosmos in motion, they believed it was necessary to let their own blood on a daily basis. So if you hear fireworks going off in town in the early morning, different neighborhoods that happen throughout the year, there are historians who link that tradition back to these daily bloodletting rituals that were practiced in the early morning to push the sun up. Then the Spanish introduced gunpowder and turned it into a Catholic event. So if you ask the people, why do you do that? They'll tell you something like, well, we're calling the angels down because a saint is being moved from one church to another. Or we're starting a Catholic procession and waking people up to participate. They've forgotten or they've lost touch with where it comes from, which is actually bloodletting. And if you want to hear more about the connection between those two traditions from a historian who's written several articles linking them and have one of the best tours you can have in San Miguel, I highly recommend that you visit the Mask Museum at Casa de la Cuesta. Bill and Heidi, the owners, have an extensive collection of ceremonial masks they've been collecting for many years. And he is an expert on that, and she is an expert on Otomi art. Itself, all the stone that you see in the garden is rubble filled They follow the description. They just organize in this space. And they're making spending in the bowl. Each room has a different type of plant on display, non-wooden products, domestic utensils, edible, combustible, construction, ornamental, medicinal, and ceremonial. And the ceremonial room, you're not going to see any of these event plants on display.
Very precise, with smooth stucco covering it, and painted in the four colors that represent each cardinal direction. Red for the east and the rising sun, black for the west and the land of the dead, white for the north, and yellow for the south. So geometric patterns, religious symbols painted over it, but all of the stucco and paint is disintegrated. But I'm going to show you where some of the pigments come from. This is original pottery. This is original pottery. The red stuff that you see is called polished red, a common style in this region. This other stuff is called raised white. And the abstract pattern that you see painted on the pot is a unique style of art that is isolated to this area and more similar to what's found in the American Southwest or northern Mexico. Because throughout the rest of Mesoamerica, during the same time period, you had mainly what's called codex style, which are gods, goddesses, glyphs, precisely drawn images in bold, contrasting colors. Here, abstract patterns and earth tones. The red pigment for red paint comes from the stem of that little plant with no leaves on it because the leaf cutter ants have cut them away. Yellow from a hallucinogenic yellow flower, all mixed with the juice of the nopal cactus to make paint. But the plants have multiple uses. The roots of the sangregado can be ground up and mixed with water and rubbed into the scalp to regenerate hair growth in older men. The big bush that you see is called limoncillo. The leaves of the bush are made into a tea that cleans out the kidneys and liver. And this one is called palo dulce. The juice from the bark of this tree helps to cure gastrointestinal problems. And if you peel away the bark and chop off the trunk into pieces and then soak it in water, after about 2 hours, the water turns blue, and that is used to eliminate parasites from livestock, mainly small animals like chickens and sheep. So you have human and animal remedies all around you. And one unique process was invented thousands of years ago, without which we would not be looking at pyramids right now, because large populations never would have been supported if someone had not invented the process called Nix Tamal. Nix Tamal is what the word tamal or tamari comes from, and that's where you take the dry stored corn from the previous year's harvest, you soak it in water mixed with the mineral lime, which softens it, and it can be mashed up into masa to make tortillas. If you don't soak the corn in lime water, you have no access to the niacin or the amino acid the corn produces, so it has very little nutritional value. So when they started exporting corn to places like Africa, the US, and other parts of the world where people in poor rural areas became dependent upon it, they developed an epidemic called pellagra, which is a niacin deficiency. So how did they figure that out thousands of years ago? The trial and error over thousands of years to create these herbal remedies, the mathematical, astronomical, and architectural genius put into the building of a site like this tells us that these people are reaching a very high level of intelligence, tapping into different regions of the brains we don't use as much today, using much more of their brain's capacity because they had to process, learn, use, and transmit this information to the next generation in a very short amount of time. The average life expectancy was only 45, the average height only about 4.5 feet. They passed this information down orally, memorizing it through songs, poems, even dance, and painting in those bark paper books called a codex. They had to record very accurately some of the stuff they were monitoring in the sky because some of the cycles they were monitoring lasted several generations. They had to leave behind accurate records, most of which, of course, were burned by the Spanish. So this high level of intelligence could be attributed to the fact that they were never distracted by modern technology, the ingestion of certain plants which alter the chemistry of the brain, possibly even cranial deformation, changing of the shape of one's skull, which I'm going to talk about here shortly when I talk about different forms of physical alteration. But for now, we're going to head towards the center of the sun. You'll see what I mean. So if you can see large vessels for storing food or water, painted bases for cups, different colors and styles, and the cups themselves were used to consume pulque, the fermented sap of the maguey cactus, an inebriating beverage consumed in large quantities by the elite during ceremony. Common people were not allowed to drink that except during the 10th month of their year, which is dedicated to honoring the dead, which is basically what the Day of the Dead comes from. So the Spanish encountered the Aztecs, honoring the dead during their, what's our modern day August, and they moved it to correspond with All Saints Day and All Souls Day. That's a little form of syncretism, the blending of the two religions. So it was an inebriating beverage, and common people were not allowed to drink it except during that 10th month of their year, dedicated to honoring the deceased. But if you were born on the day overseen by the Lord of Pulque, every day overseen by a different deity, if you were born on that day, you were allowed to drink. If you reached age 52, a complete cycle, then you were allowed to drink from that point on.
Even yoga-style posturing allowed these priests to achieve enhanced visions of the plume of smoke rising like a serpent, its mouth opening, and a human head emerging from the mouth of the snake. That was the ancestor with whom they were communicating. And if you've seen Aztec or Mayan art, you've probably seen that repeated, the open snake's mouth, the human head coming out. It's basically a reference to ancestral veneration or ancestor worship, but to be more precise, communication with and receiving guidance from the dead was their main objective. They believe the dead have a unique perspective and influence over the living, and were consulted constantly for guidance. And that's why they were buried right beneath the floor, so they were constantly in communication with their deceased ancestors. Rare opportunity to have a seat, if anyone wants to have a seat right here, while I talk about the House of the Wind, from the east to the west. That western orientation is extremely rare. Most ceremonial centers like this are oriented towards the east, so the sun and moon rise out of the main pyramid on certain dates. In this case, it's the opposite, oriented towards the setting sun and moon's western horizon, considered the land of the dead. They believe the priests that lived here may have been what they call the cult of the dead, dedicated to honoring the deceased in the underworld, partially because of this western orientation. On the top of that platform, there's a rectangular structure. It's called the adoratorio, or the place of worship. A lot of the ceremony involved in giving honor to the god of the wind included the sprinkling of sacrificial blood for the four cardinal directions, or four winds. And I'm sure that happened up there, but they also discovered the burial of a woman about 25 years old at the time of death. She had late-stage tuberculosis. She had scratch marks on her forearm bones from what was probably ritual bloodletting before death, and bite marks in her bones about the size of a wolf's tooth. Now, some of the forensics people believe the wolves may have been set loose upon the woman as a means of sacrifice. Others believe it was a natural death and she was placed there later as an offering. But fragments of human bone unrelated to each other were found scattered about the patio floor, as well as the floors of complex A and B. And that is the form of ritual cannibalism that took place. Heads, hands, and feet were missing on many of the burials. Intelligence, artistry, and movement. Three parts of the body that are the most important. Also, your identity. Now, 11 human burials were found beneath one floor on the other side of the main patio, all congregated in that one room, out of which the Milky Way galaxy rises in late August, and that was their patron deity, Mishkoatl, which means cloud serpent. So it seems as if they were arranging their burials according to what was happening in the sky. But those people, most of them were missing those parts of the body. And the lead archaeologist, Gabriella, believes they may have been members of a dynasty that was overthrown after an internal revolt. Those parts of the body removed as a way of erasing them from history. Possibly even consumed by the more elite-level priests as a way of ingesting their power. That was her theory, at least. So, physical alteration is something I mentioned as an aspect of Mesoamerican culture, which included cranial deformation. Tying cloth and boards tightly to a baby's skull to be elongated into what some interpret as the shape of a corn cob. Hair tied into a tassel at the top, just like the corn tassel coming from the top of the corn cob. So they were emulating what they ate and what they worshipped, the god of corn. Sometimes the heads were flat on top and bulging on the sides, like the shape of a bean. So back then, you really were what you ate. You can see this very clearly at sites down in southern Mexico, mostly in the Mayan area, where they have museums with glass cases and different shaped skulls laid out, so you can see the different shapes. They would also slice open the top part of the nose and place a piece of shell under the skin to enhance the arch. They would sew it back to enhance the arch of the nose and represent royalty. Sometimes fitting a piece of shell that was carved and fit into that shape onto the nose to enhance the arch. Ear spools made of shell jade and turquoise. Shell jade and turquoise inlaid teeth. Dental deformation. Lip spools. Nose rings with elaborate figures dangling from them, scarification, tattooing, piercing. They would even dangle an object between a female's eyes to make them cross-eyed, something they considered beautiful among the elite. So all those features indicated elite status and beauty, so the elite looked like an entire race unto themselves, completely separate from the common people. And this is where I have to make a distinction between the Maya and the rest of Mesoamerica. The Maya are the most famous of all Mesoamerican peoples because they took everything to its most advanced, extreme, and refined level. They had a writing system that could portray anything spoken. Central Mexicans never went beyond place names and dates. They had a much more elaborate and intricate form of art and architecture. And the calendar system that went above and beyond what Central Mexicans use, which I'll be explaining to you later when I talk about 2012 and how that fit into it. They had the only people in this hemisphere with the concept of zero, and they even took cranial deformation to an extreme. The elite Maya elongated their skulls so much that some of them died from fracturing that occurred at the top where the bone became too thin, or from hemorrhaging that occurred. But some people theorize this may be one of the ways they were able to tap into different regions of their brains, making this high level of intelligence possible. But we've never taken a baby in modern times and molded its head into a different shape to test that out.
Join us again for part two, The Pyramid. Albert Coffey will share his wealth of knowledge of the House of Winds, the House of the Longest Night, the Sunken Patio, the Mesoamerican Bob Court, and the Pyramid itself. You will learn of many unique secrets and features that make the Pyramid at Cañada de la Virgen one of the most important finds in the history of Mesoamerican culture. The world is a book, and those who do not travel read only a page.